All right. So, I'll be on behalf of everyone. Shanthi, what do we all we know to say is a big old roll tide.
Right, that's all we know to say right now.
And for all of our roll tiders in the room, and we know that's about half of you, can we get a shout out to Big Al for joining our Alabama prep session? What are the chances of that? Like, Big Al, thank you. Tell Coach Saban, we love him.
Oh.
Oh, I hope I've made him big on your screens. I really tried to make sure that he was pinned for you. All right, now I think we have another guest, do we not? Let me see. Let me scratch up a little bit. So I think for our Auburn friends, there we go. There we go. Thank you for spotlighting.
And we apologize. The real Albie is next door at an exhibition basketball game, so.
Well, will you tell them, Dr. Crow, who you are? Because while we may not have the OG Albie, will you tell them who you are and what awesome things that you do?
My name is Laura Crow. I serve as the East Alabama Regional In-Service Center Director here at Auburn University. And just like Holly Morgan, who's on the call, we provide professional development experiences. We serve 15 local school districts as far north as Alexander City, Tallapoosa County, and as far south as Barber County and Eufaula City.
So can we get a hearty war eagle for everyone but our Michigan friend, or those that root for one or the other? We want to know who. Oh, I see we've got some go dogs here. Hold on. And Dr. Morgan, I'm so sorry I did not see you join. Will you introduce yourself as well?
Hey, sure. Like Laura, I serve as the In-Service Center Director for the UAUWA region. We're so glad to see so many of you on tonight. And if you are in Region 4 in the West Alabama region, we look forward to serving you. Lamar, all the way down to Choctaw County.
Thank you, Dr. Morgan. So I know Shanthi would join me and say these two ladies are amazing. Some of the most servant-hearted educators I have ever known. And it's so funny because one is at Alabama, Tuscaloosa, and one is at Auburn, and they love each other and they do some amazing work together. So we want to thank them for being here tonight, and we want you to know if these are not your regions, guess what? There is one of these amazing people in your region that serve to provide professional learning for wherever you. So every week I ask you, what region are you from? Because I wanted you to know it in your heart. So I want you to know there is a director in your region whose sole job is to provide professional learning and support to you and your schools. So reach out to them, Dr. Morgan, Dr. Crow. These 221 teachers that you see are here because they're emergency certificate teachers, and we're a little biased, but they are amazing. They come every Wednesday night. We can't make them log off. We have to tell them at 9 o'clock it's time to go to sleep. Because they just stay asking all these wonderful questions and they love this community. And so we thank you both for being part of this evening tonight. And Big Al and Albie, that is awesome too. So we hope, I tried to warn you last night, if you got some little ones who are big Alabama Auburn fans, this is a good time to make sure that they join the party. So with this, William, if you don't mind, if you go ahead and share your screen so we don't have to share it twice. We are going to be doing some moving and shaking. So we've done that before, and we wanted to make sure that we kind of prepped you for that. But just like the last time, once you go to this new place, you will not be coming back. So make sure that you fill out that the attendance form and your assignment that Dr. Maxey gave us. It is so important to us, yes, that you fill out the form, yes, that you do your homework. But we try to get better each time because your feedback, we change a little bit each week to make sure that we're answering your questions. Some of you had asked for some elementary and secondary sessions. So thank you, William, right there. So just a reminder, I think this goes without saying, but we are recording. If you have been watching the recordings, you see we always kind of splice out the breakout rooms and the after session conversation because we want you to feel very open to ask questions and be vulnerable. Make remember everything is where it should be on that prep resource document. And we just ask that what you learn tonight, that you take back to your classroom, that you use it for impact, and that, you know, you really be present in these sessions. I think I've mentioned this before, but every presenter, every single person that has come to join you, not a single person is being paid for this. There is no overtime. There is no stipend. These folks are coming because they want to pay it forward, because we've all been in your shoes and we wish someone had been there to, you know, throw us a rope to provide support. So I always try to make sure that we recognize the many people that have joined us tonight, just because they really want to provide support. We go to the next slide. I'm a little sad about this. So yes, this is week 9. We have an amazing night for you. Going to share lots of resources that you can use tomorrow. We're really excited to hear which of those you choose to use and how they impacted your classroom. So with that, Ms. Washington, can you think of anything we've not said before we pass it off to our key presenters tonight?
No, I think you've just about covered it all. Just sit back, relax, and hold on, because you're going to experience another awesome session tonight with our two presenters.
Absolutely. Thank you. All right, Ms. Gilliland, Mr. Jones, all yours.
Thank you, Dr. Shields, for that introduction. I think we're about to do some movement. So I'm actually going to, we're going to dive right in. We have a couple of different things that are happening here in just a few seconds. Sue Ellen, feel free to jump in here and help explain some of the movement that's going to happen. But we're going to ask our K-6 teachers, they're going to stay here in this Zoom room, and they're going to work with the amazing Karen Thorne and a couple of other folks that are going to share some resources with them. I'm going to jump in and out to share some ACAP resources, but you all will be in this room for the majority or for the rest of the night. However, our secondary teachers, we wanted to provide some real targeted support for you all for those grades 6, 7, and 8. Again, sixth grade, as you can see, can choose their best option. So based maybe on how your building is set up, if you're self-contained or if you're departmentalized, that may help you make that decision. But our grade 6 through 12, we're going to put a link in the chat for you here in just a second. And we're all going to jump on another Zoom in another Zoom room so that we can talk in that secondary language, in that secondary world, and give you some more targeted support. So I'm actually about to stop sharing, and I'm going to let Karen, if she will, or whoever's going to present for their team, to kind of take the lead in this room so I can also be in the other Zoom room to start letting some folks in.
So
So at this time, Steve Blair will put a link in the chat. If you are a teacher of 7th through 12th grade students, you will want to join this new link. If you are a teacher of kindergarten through 6th grade, stay right where you are. 6th grade, if you want to choose and you're more at the middle school level, just I think we lost her for a second. So go ahead, as she's getting recalibrated there. You'll see Steve put a link in the chat. So for those of you that teach 7 through 12, now if you're a 6th grade teacher, we did this the last time too. It's a little bit of a judgment call, but you choose the one that you think would most fit you. If you serve a 6-8 school, you might want to go secondary. If you're in a K-6 school, you might want to stay elementary. So for you 6th grade teachers, that is really up to you which of those rooms you choose to join. Remember, as you were leaving, we will not see you till next Wednesday. So we will follow up with an email soon.
Awesome. Okay. Thank you so much, Dr. Shields.
You're welcome. I'm going to put that link in the chat again because I know we've had a lot kind of come and go. Yep.
Karen, are you,
thank you,
good? You're muted though, Karen.
Okay. Can you hear me now?
Yes. Thank you.
Okay. Great. Yes, I'm ready to go. And Jennifer, are you ready to go?
Yes, ma'am. I'm ready. Okay. Styling with my beach hat. Feeling like it's warm.
Okay. Well, all I have is a Lumio hat, and this is not, I know we're not trying to push Lumio tonight, but this is also another great resource for educators to use that hopefully we can bring out at another time. It's a little bit more complex for what we can do tonight, but a really good free resource for teachers. So anyway, just throwing on a cap, but I think I'm going to take that off for just a bit, okay? So are we ready to go, Dr. Shields? Are we still hanging on?
Absolutely. I think everybody's kind of moved out. Miss Washington, okay. I will watch the chat. We need to sneak someone in the other session, but yep, it's all yours.
Okay. Well, I'm going to share my screen then, okay? And since that was very seamless, then we're going to go ahead and move on, okay? And let me just move a couple of things around so that y'all can see my screen better. Can everyone see my screen? So far? Okay. Everyone see my screen? Well, Melissa, give me a thumbs up if you can see my screen. Okay, perfect. All right, like Dr. Shields said, we're very happy that you're here tonight and very excited and very proud of what you do in the classroom, serving our students every day, because that is such a huge role. And we all know we've been where you are, and we know how challenging and how difficult it can be. But we also know that there's a lot of joy and a lot of rewards in what you do every day. So we are here to help you and to encourage you and support you in any way that you need. I am Dr. Karen Thorne. I am an Alabama Technology in Motion Specialist. And I'll tell you a little bit about what we do. There are actually 11 of us across the state. We all serve different regions of the state, just like our regional in-service centers do. And we come into schools, or we have professional development, and we provide support for teachers in integrating technology and computer science and digital literacy. And so there's a lot of different things that we can do to support you and your classroom and your instruction. So if you do not know who your Alabama Technology in Motion Specialist is, in your region, I encourage you to reach out to your regional in-service center or go to our website at atm.us and look us up and see and find your regional in-service center or your Alabama Technology and Motion Specialist. We are a free resource. We are funded by the state. And so we also have a lot of resources and tools that we can bring out to the school, or we can actually loan to you to work with your students. So we're very excited and very happy to come out and help you. And we want to do everything that we can that's in our power to help you be a successful teacher. So never worry about reaching out to us or feeling like we're going to come into your classroom and be judgmental or anything like that. That's not our role. We all want to help you and strengthen you and encourage you and just provide what you need and what your students need. So like I said, just feel free to reach out to us at any time and we'll be glad to help you. And again, if you don't know who your ATM is, please make sure to look us up because we're there and we're available to help you.
Karen, I put our website in the chat.
Oh, thank you. Thank you very much. Today, we're gonna look at a resource that involves artificial intelligence. Now, I don't have to tell you that there are tons and tons of resources out there that we could choose from. Tons and tons of our online resources for educators, for elementary educators. So many we couldn't possibly go through in a night. But we decided that we would look at an artificial intelligence resource tonight for a couple of reasons. That artificial intelligence is booming right now. You've probably heard a lot about it. You've probably have seen and read a lot about it. And you're going to hear more and more about it. And how you're probably thinking, how is that going to impact what I do every day? And, you know, one of the things that we want to do is always show teachers how to work smarter, not harder, because we know that you got a lot on your plate. We know there's a lot of things to do during the course of the day. And we know that time is of the essence every single day into what you can fit in. And, you know, one of our things is we want to be able to show teachers how you can take some things and make them easier so that your focus can be more on the instructional piece and planning for what you're going to do for instruction and putting your emphasis on that rather than a lot of the back things that go into that process. So we've chosen an artificial intelligence tool today that we want to share with you, and we want to show you some of the amazing things that this resource can do. However, I always want to begin any session that I do with artificial intelligence about kind of giving you some, I hate to say warnings, but I guess in essence, they really are warnings. And maybe just some information. But of course, with artificial intelligence, there are safety and privacy concerns with artificial intelligence. Now, the resource that we're going to show you tonight is a resource that teachers would use. This is not really a resource that you would have students participate or, you know, log into or doing anything like that, because it's predominantly a teacher resource. But there are some artificial intelligence resources out there that are made for students to use. So I always want to preface this by saying, you know, always be careful when you are engaging students in any type of artificial intelligence tool that you are protecting and maintaining the security and privacy and safety of your students. Also, I always encourage you to make sure that you know what your board policy is on allowing students to use and engage in artificial intelligence resources, because we want to make sure that we are following the guidelines of our state, of our district, and those types of things. So, Jennifer, do you have anything else that you want to add to that with me?
No, I mean, you pretty much covered it. You just really need to know what your rules and regulations are for your district before you. And some of these may be blocked by your IT people, but I think the one tonight we're going to show you is something you're going to find very useful.
Okay, thank you. I also want to point out something else is that, you know, anything that you're creating for student use, always preview it. Always read over it, make sure that it's legitimate, make sure it's factual, make sure there's nothing that's been created or generated that's inappropriate. Again, we go back to safety of the student. And so, like I said, make sure that we never divulge any kind of personal information about students, school, anything like that could be a breach in our students', privileged rights. So just want to make sure, like I said, and preface that before we begin, because some of you may have already experimented with artificial intelligence tools. Some of you, this may be completely new and you've not heard of that. You've not done any of those and you're not familiar with that. So like I said, just a word of caution before we begin that we know what we're doing and we're making sure that we're not compromising any of the safety with our students. But we do believe that we have a great tool for you tonight. I've already introduced myself, but I'm going to let Jennifer introduce herself and tell you a little bit about her.
So my name is Jennifer Priest. I'm the newest technology and motion specialist, and I serve Region 2. That's Blount County, Coleman County, Morgan County, Oneonta City. I also have Lawrence and Limestone counties. So I am your technology and motion specialist if you are in Region 2. And I have taught in Blount County for 18 years and worked in Arab City as their tech integration specialist before coming to ATM. So I'm just excited to be here tonight and excited to share some tools with you all and hope you find it useful. And again, I like what Karen said, I really appreciate everything that you guys are doing and taking a leap of faith and, stepping into the classroom without having all of the things that you need. So thank you.
And I'll just add to my introduction that I am the Alabama Technology and Motion Specialist for Region 1. And so I work out of the University of North Alabama. So I cover, I've got 14 school districts and 104 schools. So I'm up in the northwestern part of the state. And so I serve lots and lots of teachers and lots of districts, just like Jennifer does, just like all of us do, actually. If you are in our region and you haven't contacted us, please do. And if you're not in our regions, please make sure to reach out to your technology and motion specialist because we'll be glad to help you. Okay, we have a few goals that we hope to accomplish this evening. And our first goal is to understand how technology tools can be used to enhance learning. Because everything and every decision that we make every single day as an educator has to do with the student and has to do with the overall success of the student. So we're hoping tonight that we can show you some tools that are going to help enhance learning and help improve that overall learning and academic success of the student. Oops. And then our goal two is to understand how technology tools can be used to make learning accessible for all students. Because as former teachers, we are completely aware that your classroom is made up of students of many different backgrounds at many different levels that come with their own success stories, but come with their own challenges as well. And so you are charged every day with making sure that that learning is meeting the needs of all your individual students in the classroom. And that can be a challenging and time-consuming job. So we're hoping that showing you this tool tonight will aid you in being able to make that learning accessible to all the students that you're serving every single day. And then goal three is to understand how artificial intelligence can be used to generate classroom content. And again, generating classroom content to help make your life easier, that you can free up more time that you can devote to instructional goals for those students. Okay, so tonight the tool that we are going to look at is called Magic School AI. And so, like I said, some of you may have heard of this tool, some of you may not have. But Magic School AI is a relatively new tool that has come on board ever since kind of when AI started coming out back in last fall, when it started really being widely known, especially in the world of education. And we all know AI's been around a while. You may not have realized that there are a lot of things that you use every day that involve AI, such as a Google Map, such as your Siri on your phone, those type things. So AI's been around really since the 60s, but we haven't really been familiar with it. We haven't really recognized its role in our everyday lives. And then back in November of 22, when ChatGPT kind of hit the ground running, it really opened the world of AI for educators and just people in general. And so since that time, we are seeing more and more companies and more creators who are inventing or creating artificial intelligence tools. And a lot of those are focused on educators. And I often say, if I would have had some of these tools when I was in the classroom, my life would have been completely different. And I probably would have done things a lot different. So looking at what Magic School AI is, it's just basically an online artificial intelligence tool that you can use to design and create personalized learning experiences for students based on their individual needs. It's also a tool that includes many time-saving tools that will help teachers and make your life easier. Now, when I say it creates personalized learning experience, that honestly is a small portion of what it will actually do. What I am noticing with Magic School AI and with a lot of these other artificial intelligence tools is they are frequently updating their tool so that it includes more advanced and additional tools. So every time I open one of these artificial intelligence tools, it's now been created to do something different and do something better and do something more challenging. So I encourage you, when you go, if you choose this to do something with and you go in later and you look at it, don't just stop there. Go back at it, hopefully in the next week or the next 2 weeks. And I can tell you, you're probably going to see a new tool or a new resource there, because that's exactly what I see. I did notice within the last few days that Magic School AI has become one of the add-ons that you can put into your Google account. And so you can add that on. You can just go to the Chrome Web Store. And if you don't know how to use that, simply go to Google and type in the Google box, Chrome Web Store, and it's going to take you to there, and then type in Magic School AI. And it's going to allow you to save that as an add-on. And then you can pin that up to your Google bar. And then you can access it with actually out having to go to the website. So again, that's a new update there that makes it much, much easier for you to access. But tonight, we are just simply going to go to the website. And the website is just simply Magic School AI. Now, I have put a link here so that when you have access to this presentation, all you have to do is just click on this link and go to Magic School AI. I'm going to give you a minute to kind of look at this. If you want to write it down, you can. Just Magic School AI. Then I'm going to click on it. And this is where it's going to take me, okay? Now, I already have created an account. And so I'm going to log in with the account that I've already created. To create my account, I simply used my Gmail account that I already have, and I signed up with that account. You can actually do the same thing if you have a Gmail account. Now, once again, let me caution you about making sure if you sign up with a Gmail account that you are following your district's, rules and regulations, because I have been told that some districts have asked their teachers not to sign up for outside accounts with their Gmail account. So if that's the case, you may have to sign up with another email address that you have, or even go into Google and create your own personal Gmail account, which is very easy and very quick to do. So just a heads up on that. But tonight I'm going to log in, and you can see that I have two choices here. I have a choice that says log in, or I have a choice that says sign up for free. So again, if you haven't signed up, if you don't have an account, you're going to go right here. If you do have an account, you're just going to click log in. So I'm going to do that. Okay, and then because I'm already logged into my Google account, it's going to automatically send me into the Magic School AI. And so what does this look like? Okay, you notice that when I log in, I am going to see, they call them the magic tools, but you're going to see when I scroll down, I mean, I can scroll down, you know, a long way, and you're going to see all these fabulous tools that are in there. And it's not possible, again, for us to show you all these tools in there, but Jennifer and I are going to show you some of the tools that we feel like have been really really successful in helping educators as they navigate all their daily responsibilities. So, like I said, I just scrolled down because I just wanted you to see that there are a lot of tools available to you in this one online tool called Magic School AI. So a lot of times when I say something like that, you think, oh, it's just one tool, like kind of like ChatGPT. Actually, no. In this tool, you're going to have a lot of individual tools that you can use. So tonight, let me go back to the, Okay, I'll move on right here. All right, tonight I want to show you a few tools that I have used that I think are absolutely wonderful and time-saving tools. And then Jennifer is going to do the same. So I'm going to scroll down. And one of the tools that I think is a really good tool is called Informational Text Generator. As a former teacher and as a former elementary school principal, this was one of the areas that I saw students struggle in, is informational text. They liked fiction texts. They liked reading stories. They liked reading things that were fun and interesting. But when you came to technical text or when you came to informational text, not so much. I also know that teachers sometimes struggled with finding pieces of informational text, especially short pieces or short passages that they could share with students that would help them understand informational text, and so that they could really feel like that those students were successful in understanding some of the standards that the teachers were given concerning informational text. So this, if you notice right here, it says informational text generator generates original informational text for your class, choosing between literary nonfiction, expository, argument, or persuasion, and procedural texts customized to the topic of your choice. So I'm going to click on this tool. And notice that when I click on that tool, it's basically going to come up with some boxes for me to choose what I want to do. So very, very simple, very, very simple for you to do. Another thing that I also want to point out is we know that elementary teachers, especially lower elementary teachers, struggle with the time constraints every day in the classroom because they're heavily focused on reading, heavily focused on math. And we completely understand that. But we also know that science and social studies instruction is also very important. And so how do we mesh those two and still deal with the time constraints that we have in the classroom? Because we're always, again, looking for ways to work smarter, not harder. So how can we take, maybe our ELA standards that we are teaching and mesh those with a science or social studies standard? And then we're like killing two birds with one stone. We're actually taking one time frame and we're teaching standards in more than one curriculum area. So that's one of the things that I wanted to share with you tonight. So again, back in this informational text generator, I'm going to use a first grade. I'm going to go with first grade, and I'm going to use a literary nonfiction. Again, I can go down here and I can click and I can choose any grade from kindergarten through college. But for tonight's example, I'm going to choose first grade. Again, I can go here in the type of text and I can choose literary nonfiction. I can choose expository. I can use augmentative or persuasive, and I can use procedural. So for tonight's example, I'm going to use literary nonfiction. And then I can also choose the text length that I want Magic School AI to generate. So if I click on the down arrow, notice that I can choose from one paragraph, one page, two pages, and three pages. Again, what you choose is going to be based on the grade level and the class that you are teaching. So since I'm doing this for first grade students, I'm going to choose one paragraph. And then I can put in a topic. So it says to be as specific as possible. So here I have, I've got a couple course of studies. I've gotten the first grade social studies course of study. And I've got the first grade science course of study. So let's look at one of the science standards for first grade. And one of the science standards is standard 8. And it says, observe, describe, and predict patterns of the sun, moon, and stars as they appear in the sky. So again, this is a piece of text that I want to generate for my students. So I'm going to say, describe and predict patterns of the sun, moon, and stars as they appear in the sky. And notice that I'm gonna have to fix my misspelling, but notice that I'm actually taking this directly from an Alabama course of study standard in science, okay? But I'm also trying to integrate this into my ELA instruction. So now I'm going to click generate, and it's going to take just a few seconds. And now, look what it has generated over here. Notice that it has my prompts in here. And then it has created a one paragraph passage for me that is going to be a piece of informational, it's a piece of informational text that I can use with my students to do a learning activity. And now I can bring that back to and connect that to an ELA standards. For example, identify the main topic and key details of literary and informational texts, or ask and answer questions about key details in literary and informational texts. So that is standards 21 and 22 under comprehension in our ELA course of study. So think about how long that took to generate that piece of text that now when I use that as an instructional piece for first grade students, now understand that I now have covered course of study standards and actually science and ELA. So think about the time saver that that's going to be. Now, let me add something else to that, okay?
Hey, so Karen, can I pop in?
Yes, ma'am.
Just one quick thing, because I'm seeing some, you know, chatter in the chat, but just as a reminder for those of you that teach grades 3, 4, 5, and 6, ACAP writing, which is the assessment our students will take at the end of the year, there's a reading portion, there's a writing portion, there's a listening portion, and there's like an ELA portion. Just for clarity, and this is why it's so critical that Karen and Jennifer are sharing this, the listening, reading, and writing sections are largely based in social studies and science. It'll be read this article about weather and write about it and be able to provide text evidence about it. So that's another thing I just wanted to throw out there. This is a great prep, no pun intended, for the ACAP assessment at the end of the year.
Absolutely. And that's one of the beauties of a tool like this, because it's so quick and it's so easy. And you can simply throw a standard in there and create a piece of text like this that has to do with social studies or science, and do these lessons with these students and engage them in writing and thinking and comprehension activities. And you see how long it took to actually do that. One of the things I also want to share with you, okay, at the bottom, you're going to see some little buttons down here. Again, pretty much these are self-explanatory, and I'm not going to go into a whole lot of detail with them. You can actually increase the text length or shorten the text length. For example, if you felt like this paragraph was too long, you could shorten it, or if it wasn't long enough, you could lengthen it, you know, those types of things. But one of the things I want to show you is you can also click on the button and you can generate questions concerning this passage here. So you can choose multiple choice questions. And when you choose multiple choice questions, now it's going to generate questions. These happen to be, again, like I said, multiple choice questions from the passage that you generated here. So if you want to do some, I guess just some questioning to see have students their comprehension, if you want to do a quick formative assessment at the end of your instruction to see if students are understanding, comprehending what they're reading, or even what you're describing orally and working on those listening skills, this is a great way to do it. I also want to show you another tool in here as well. Notice that there is a tool called Translate. And this to me is an extremely valuable tool, because I know a lot of teachers work with students who are English as a second language. I happen to come from schools and work with schools as an administrator that had a minimum of 50% EL students. So if I would have had a tool like this that would have translated text into the language that students speak and can understand and comprehend, I could have made that instruction and teaching of those standards so much better and so much stronger for those students. And so I'm going to click on this Translate tool, And notice all the different types of languages that you can choose from. For purposes tonight, I'm just going to click on Spanish because I think that's probably one of the most common languages that our students are speaking in our schools. But notice that now I have that passage in English, and now I also have that passage in Spanish. So not only has it generated and created a piece of informational text for me, it has also translated that piece of informational text into a language that my students can understand based on the language that they speak. So again, we are making that learning accessible to all of our students. Okay, something else that I want to show you as well. Let's say that we are teaching first grade, but let's say that I have some students in there that are not quite at the, let me see if I can move that a little bit so I can see that kindergarten, that are not quite reading at first grade level. Notice that I can actually change the grade level and I can regenerate. So I can regenerate so that the passage is more their grade level appropriate. So, you know, you're going to see some of this, especially as we go up in the grade level, because we know that sometimes we're teaching third grade, but we may be, teaching special education students or even EL students or even just some regular ed students that are behind in reading that may not be successful in the standard that we're teaching them because they simply can't read the passage. But on the flip side, something else I want to show you is that let's say that you have advanced students or gifted students in your classroom, and they are also reading above grade level. So that's one of the areas I think sometimes it's hard for us to do, is that we sometimes are not extending the learning and providing those advanced learning opportunities for our students that have already met the standards or exceeding the standards already. So you can change the grade level here and again, regenerate. And regenerate a different, an advanced, more advanced passage. Notice that it says the sun, moon, and stars are celestial, which that was not in the other passages. So now you're going to see an increased vocabulary. You're going to see, a more complex and a higher reading level for those students that are advanced. So again, you've got a one-stop shop of creating informational text at a level that meets your students, while you are meeting the students that may be below grade level, meeting the students that are above grade level, and also, meeting the students if they're speaking a different language. I also want to show you another little tool that's involved in this. It's called Ask Raina. And if I type something in there, this is kind of an AI tool for an AI tool. It's kind of funny, but I may say, provide five comprehension questions. And I can press enter. And now it's actually going to provide me just some comprehension questions that while you are working with your students that you may want to orally ask your students or even have your students work to discuss this. And again, this is part of your ELA standard, but at the same time, you are covering your standard for your, this happens to be science. I'll show you an example of a social studies, just a quick example. But again, think about the amount of standards that you're covering all at one time. So like I said, really, really great tool. I'm gonna go back here really quick and I'm going to go back into first grade, and I'm going to go to a first grade history, a social studies standard, just so you can see what that looks like. And this one says, hang on a minute. It says, identify past and present forms of communication. Okay, so this is standard 6 in your first grade social studies course of study, Alabama course of study. Okay, so once again, you see that it's generated a quick paragraph that is at a first grade level and with the types of different communication. So now you are covering a standard. And the standard actually says, compare ways individual and groups and local communities and states and state lived in the past and how they live today. So now, within a matter of 5 seconds, you have generated an informational text passage that's going to provide you with the information that you need to cover a social studies standard and ELA standards. And again, I can also click down here and create multiple choice questions or free response questions that can be used for, like I said, teacher just gauging for understanding, formative assessment that teachers can use to put students in groups or students at centers and allow them to respond. So like I said, just a really, really great tool. And this is the informational text generator. So I hope you like that. And I hope you feel that it will be very easy for you to use, because you actually see, I didn't really do a whole lot of work. I simply chose the grade. I simply chose what type of text. I chose the length of the text. And I simply just typed in a course, Alabama course of study standard. And that's it, to gauge and get the information that I needed. So I hope you enjoyed that tool. Jennifer, would you like to go ahead and share one of your tools, please?
Sure.
We'll take turns.
Karen, yeah, okay, I hate to interrupt, but I think I'm supposed to jump in here.
Okay.
If that's okay. We're gonna that's Jennifer, okay. I apologize for cutting you off, but I think I'm in the middle of this group, and then I have to jump to the middle group. So we're gonna bounce around a little bit, if that's all right.
That's okay. Sure.
Okay, I'm going to share my screen. Hopefully, this works out. Let me make sure I am where I need to be. Yep. All right. So for those that may not know, I'm a huge Whitney Houston fan. I'm going to insert here just a couple of ACAP resources that we have that are available to you. I'm going to try to go as fast as possible without going so fast that we leave people with a lot of questions, but I will try to do this efficiently. All right. You will have access to this presentation. It is linked in the main presentation for tonight. And so it's on the prep resource document. So you'll have this so you can go back, play with it, explore, look at all the things that maybe I moved through relatively quickly. For those that just have to have it right now, if you want to quickly grab this QR code before I move the screen, you can. So you'll have access to it. But again, I'm moving on, and just know that you have this link available to you inside the presentation. That all boils down to what you're doing in tiered instruction and that tier one core instruction that is founded in your course of study standards. And so I'm just going to skip some of that. I'm going to hit those big resources again. Remember, we've got Alabama standards. This website is linked here. Again, we've talked about it before, but everything we do in our classroom is based here in our course of study standards. We also have the Alex resources. That's another way that we present the standard that has some other links that break down. Remember, we talked about unpacking the standard. That happens on the Alex website. We have proficiency scales. We gave you those resources several weeks ago as well. We want to make sure we're utilizing those state-approved resources that kind of break down what should be happening in our classrooms. So emotional. Why do I say that? It's because sometimes we tend to, teachers, I'm a teacher myself, sometimes we gravitate to the things that we love. We gravitate to that content that we want to spend, we could spend weeks talking about it because we love it. We're going to make our kids love it, all of those things. And that's great. But we really need to focus in, and some of the resources we talk about tonight, we want to make sure that we're putting our time and our effort in those places that make the most sense and where we're going to get the most bang for our buck. And so we can't get so caught up in the emotions that come with our content as much as we're paying attention to those areas that we need to emphasize. So a couple of resources that I use leading up to those areas of emphasis, right? Some resources that I kind of have been using for years and are still out there. I will always promote the strategic teaching guide from many, many years ago. Several of you that are in the room that are old school ALSDE or educators in the room, you're going to remember this document. This was back in the day. ARI kind of reached up to some of us secondary folks and gave a ton of resources. And so want to make sure that you have this, and that you have it. It helps with your before, during, and after. If that's how you plan your instruction, but it's just filled with really great strategies. And I know that Karen has probably shared with you some AI tools that help you plan, that give you some strategies, but this is just another resource that you have that's available to you. The next thing that I'm going to point out are the Alabama Instructional Supports documents. And we'll look at those in just a second in my ACAP folder. But these documents outline exactly what we would want to see, or the type of instruction that should incorporate standards or specific standards that you may be teaching from the course of study. So if you're planning your instruction, if you're looking at, let's say I'm using a lesson plan generator, or I'm planning collaboratively, I want to make sure that that I am utilizing these documents to kind of measure the quality of my instruction. And is the instruction that I'm providing, is it to the level that students need it to be in order to be prepared for the ACAP assessment? The instructional supports documents look like similar to what you see on the screen. They give us our focus of our instruction. They give us sample activities that align to a specific standard. They help us use modeling for multiple examples. There's practice problems and practice suggestions inside those instructional supports documents. You also get sometimes you'll find a graphic organizer. Sometimes you may see vocabulary that needs to be utilized. You might see some guided or independent practice activities outlined in those instructional supports documents. Again, those are all resources. Some of you are thinking, well, I have a district approved curriculum. It outlines what I do day to day. And we're not telling you to replace that by any means. However, sometimes we need to look at our district approved curriculum and make sure that when we're talking about a particular standard, that standard is being addressed to the level and to the rigor that students are going to be expected to know when they sit to take the ACAP in the spring. You also have available to you are our performance level descriptors, PLDs. PLDs outline the four levels that we use in the accountability process. I don't want you to get caught up in the accountability word as much as I want you to understand that the PLDs outline what we believe to be the skills associated with grade level mastery. So that level three, as with a proficiency scale, level three represents grade level content and grade level mastery. So anything that's on the PLD that's listed in that level three column is going to be that kind of that goal or the target. if I can get kids to perform at mastery at that level, then I know that going into the ACAP assessment, my kids are going to perform at or above grade level mastery. So we want to make sure that we're utilizing those PLDs to help us make sure we're planning along those same lines. All right. So part of the assessment mentality that I want you to have is sort of pulling from Whitney Houston inspiration is you got to believe in you and you got to believe in your kids. I believe in you and me, and I believe in our ability to perform well on these assessments. I know sometimes we get in situations, we may be working in schools where it feels like hitting mastery and hitting grade level, getting to level three seems almost impossible. But remember, we have to operate with the mentality that my kids can perform at high levels. And we believe that they can across our state, regardless of the situation. So the other resource I'll point out here is the item specs. These are ACAP item specs, and the item specs documents break down the types of questions that a student may experience when they are seated to take the ACAP assessment as it relates to specific standards. So in the examples you see on the screen, we've got fourth grade across the screen. When we look at fourth grade, we're looking at the item specs and we're saying, for this particular standard, these are the types of questions that a kid might see. So why would that be helpful? So if I'm planning my instruction, I'm planning my assessments, and I'm about to assess students on a particular standard, then I want to make sure that I'm utilizing similar question types. Does that mean it has to look just like the ACAP? No, that's not what I'm saying. But we do want to expose students to the types of questions that they will see when they sit to take the assessment. And so the item specs documents give us those sample items, those ideas of, okay, these are the types of questions I want to be asking my kids when I assess on this standard. You get sample test items. We also gave you sample test item booklets, so you would see some of the retired questions from the ACAP, so you could pull from those. You get test blueprint. So earlier I talked about being so emotional, right? Sometimes we plan our instruction or we spend our class time on things that we enjoy as teachers. Unfortunately, that's not how we're supposed to plan. We have a course of study we're responsible for. A particular grade level that maybe 8 questions come from geometry and another 20 might come from data analysis or from measurement or from geometry. Well, that means when I'm planning my instruction that I may need to spend a little more time on geometry and a little less time on, let's say, algebraic operations or something like that. The blueprints give us an idea of where to emphasize or where to spend the majority of our time as it relates to our standards. So some assessment resources that I want to make sure that you know are available to you. One of my favorites is the AMSTI Math Assessment Item Test Bank. If you've never seen this, you want to make sure that you have saved this as a bookmark. So if I go to the item test bank, I can go here and I can say, okay, let's suppose that I teach fourth grade math. So I can go to the test bank. I can go to fourth grade. I can look at what standard am I teaching. So let's suppose that I'm teaching standard 7, read and write multi-digit whole numbers. I teach fourth grade and that's what I'm teaching. Well, what AMSTI has done is say, oh, there's a short answer question and there are multiple choice questions that are already available to you that are aligned to that standard. So I can select multiple choice, go here, open this document, and I have sample test items that are available to me. Here's a question that I can use as a bell ringer, as part of a quiz, or as part of a test that's already aligned to that particular standard. So the item test bank is available to you. AMSTI has done a great job of putting that together. And so we want to make sure we bookmark that. There's some other resources here that I don't really have time to dive into, but I wanted to make sure you have. So some additional resources. You have my ACAP folder. Here in the presentation is linked for you. So you have, let's say that I teach third grade. I go to third grade here's one of those blueprints. This is the blueprint for math. There's third grade. That tells me majority of the ACAP math assessment looks at operations and algebraic thinking, so standards 1 through 9. And then we pick up at data analysis and geometry, standards 16, leading up to, skips a few, but leading up to standard 26. So that's where the bulk of students are going to be assessed on the ACAP, which means that when I'm planning my instruction, when I'm pacing out, we talked about pacing a few weeks ago, when I'm pacing out my course, I'm making sure that I'm giving plenty of time to those standards where students are going to be assessed at a higher rate. So these folders are filled with every resource that I've talked about. So the best thing you can do is go to the ACAP folder, find your grade level, and make sure that you have that saved so you know those resources. Now, I do want to point out for my special ed teachers in the room, those of you that are supporting students that will be approved to take the alternate assessment, there is a folder inside of here that says Fall 23 ACAP Alternate. Those resources are available, some of those same resources, the item specs, the PLDs, the descriptors, the blueprints, those same documents are available to you if you are working with students that have been approved to take the ACAP Alternate assessment. So you want to make sure you're utilizing the folder that I put here. I want to be very clear that not all special ed students take ACAP alternate. Only specific students that go through a process of determination take that ACAP alternate. Our other students may take the ACAP summative, and they may take it with various accommodations. So I just want to be very clear with that. But if you're teaching special ed or working with special ed, it's important to know the students on your caseload, which one they're going to end up taking so that we're supporting them in the right way. There we go. We also have the ACAP and the ACT resources document. Dr. Shields and I update this all the time. It is a running document of all the things that encompass ACAP and ACT. Anytime something new happens, any new resource that we find, any new resources that are released, they go here. That QR code is good, but you can also open the document. Again, I bookmark it. Up at the top, you can fill out the form at the top of the document. Anytime we add something new, you're going to get an email notification that something new has been added. Here's some instructional resources I wanted you to have, and this is my contact information. If you need it, it's there for you. You can always reach out to me. I have to jump back to the secondary room. So, Karen, I'm going to stop sharing and let you take back over. I believe... Jennifer, I interrupted you, so it may be your turn, but thank you for letting me interrupt and insert some of those ACAP resources. Hopefully folks find those useful.
Thank you, William. Okay, I am going to share my screen. I never felt like I had enough word problem examples for my students, so I'm going to show you how to use this one quickly. I chose to highlight fifth grade. Karen did one of the younger grades, so I'm going to do fifth grade. So I've chosen my grade level, fifth grade, and then I can choose how many questions that I want to generate. I'm going to choose 5. I just feel like that's a pretty good number. So for my math standard, I have already opened up all of my standards that I wanted to use today. So I went to the course of study for fifth grade, and I chose the fifth grade one that says solve problems in a real world context with decimals and hundreds. So I can simply just highlight this and copy it and go back in and paste it. Oops, did not get my S in there. And then, because I know how hard it is to get to science and history, I thought it might be fun to add in a history standard for my story topic. And so I found that in my history standards, in fifth grade, students learn about the Boston Tea Party. So I'm not going to put the whole standard in there because when I did, it got kind of wonky. So I'm just going to put the Boston Tea Party, and my content is going to generate some facts about the Boston Tea Party. I'm going to generate it, and it's going to give me... I also want you to know, like Karen talked about earlier, this is not perfect. It's AI. So it's going to generate some things that maybe don't have... answers that are decimals to the hundreds, but I think these do. So I can add more questions if I want to. I can also translate it. I can shorten it. So I thought that was a good way for me to get some history context in, also with my math standard. But I did add a little bit to my objective, because when I first did it, it didn't give me exactly what I wanted, because I want my students to have an answer that they have to round to the hundreds and decimals. So I had to be a little bit more specific with it. So just know that you may have to do that sometimes also to get what you want out of it. So that's one of my favorite ones. Karen, do you want to do the next one?
Sure. Thank you, Jennifer. I'm going to go back and share my screen again. Hopefully y'all can see that. Okay, so still, like I said, still sticking with our Magic School AI, I'm going to go over here to this button and I'm going to click back on Magic Tools, because when I click back on Magic Tools, it's going to take me back to my main homepage that's going to show me the different tools that I have. And so I'm going to go down here and I'm going to look at another tool that I think is a very useful tool. And I'm going to go down to text leveler tool. Now, again, I showed you a little bit about that when I was looking at the first tool, the informational text generator. And this, that would do a lot of the same thing, but there may be times that I find text or pieces of text, or even if I've generated text, that I want to make the text a different level. Because again, if you are teaching special ed students that you need lower level text for, you are teaching EL students, or you're teaching advanced students that you want to provide more challenging pieces of text and you want to extend their learning, this is a really great piece to do that with. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go back in my Magic School AI and I'm going to go back to output history. One of the things that this tool will do is it will show you what you have created. This is a list of everything that I've done while we've been working here together. So it doesn't just go away. So I can go back, I can delete, I can save it again. I can show the full output of what I did. Okay. And so, like I said, this happens to be the Spanish version. So we will not do that one. Let me exit out of that. Let me go back in and find my English version. Okay, that may not be my English version. Let me see if I can find anything that shows. Okay, here's one that it has created, and I'm going to copy this text. And remember that this was in my output, and I'm going to go back to my tools. And I'm going to go back down here to my text leveler tool. And note, remember that was first grade text that I've worked on. But let's say that I want to bring that up to sixth grade level, okay? Maybe I have a student that's reading at the sixth grade level and is advanced. So I can copy and paste and put that in there, okay? And then I can generate, and now you're going to see on the side that it has generated a text covering the same type of content, but it has generated that text at a sixth grade reading level. Same thing if I want to lower the grade level. Let's say that I want to lower that grade level to, let's say that was a sixth grade reading text, and I'm going to copy that text. Hang on a second. It does allow you to decrease or increase the lexile level or the reading level of that text so that you can make that learning accessible to all your students. And I did that from a generated piece of text from Magic School AI. And again, you can go down here and you can translate it into a different language and so on and so forth.
That is awesome.
And I knew nothing.
One
more thing. Jennifer and I did not get, we had overplanned, so we did not get to all the tools that we wanted to be able to do tonight. But as you can see, these are very easy tools, easy tools to navigate. And, you know, basically it's just clicking and filling in the blank. And so I encourage teachers to go in and check them out and see what all they will do. And Jennifer, you may have one last parting thing to add.
Only thing I really would like to add is just, you know your standards, you know where they are, and if you use your standards while you're putting it into the AI format, then, you know you're covering your standards and it's not just something fun for you to do. So just make sure you use your standards when you're doing this.
And I'm going to, I was looking to see, I see there's several slides. And so what we want you to know, when we give you the slide deck, it has the elementary slides and it has the secondary slides. So it's everything together. So if you're like, well, we didn't discuss access because that for the high school folks, but we just thought it'd be cleaner just to put everything on one slide deck. So I am going to go to the homework assignment and then of course share the attendance links and those sorts of things. And then I hope that Jennifer and Karen will stay on. So what we were sharing, we usually end around 8:15, sometimes 8:30. And then we let them ask questions. We quit recording. So they may have some questions for you. But I certainly wanted to make sure that you had your intercession activity. So for elementary, and we know we've had some secondary folks who are like, we won't come hang out with you too. So if you are elementary, these first three will not apply to you because you did not get the access training tonight. That is specifically for high school folks. So for elementary, number four will be your only option for a homework assignment. So what we want you to do is to investigate one of those AI tools. We want you to be prepared to explain, how did you use it to ensure safe use? And remember, I know Karen said this earlier, we keep talking about AI like it's this new thing, but how many times have you gone to Amazon and you bought something? And then when you go back to Amazon, it's like, and here are 14 other things you need because you bought this. That is AI. Same thing for, you're talking, seems like I'm talking to my husband, like, I wonder, you want to go out for ice cream? And then I check my Facebook and it's like, there's an ice cream ad. I don't understand that. But AI is not new, but we know a lot of people are talking about it and we certainly want to be ahead of it. So we want you to look at some of those things that are open to you. And, they shared, oh my gosh, so many awesome resources. I kept going, where was this when I was a new teacher? Like, I couldn't even have imagined there could be such a thing. Like, it is so futuristic. But do exactly what they said. Jennifer mentioned, check with your school policy. We will not share anything that we thought would contradict that, but we're always want to err on the side of caution to make sure that any technology tool, whether it is AI enhanced or any other web-based tool, that it is in compliance with your school and district. Anything else, ladies, in regard to their homework that I did not add?
I don't think so.
Okay, awesome. And we'll be sure to share with you which ones that they use. Let me go ahead and throw the attendance link in.